Hi, and welcome to today's webinar. Thank you for joining us. Today we'll be talking about how to deploy and elastically scale data stacks on Mesosphere DCOS. My name is Erin Metzel, and I'm a product marketing manager at Mesosphere, and today I have with me Catherine Erickson from DataStacks. Catherine, do you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. Thanks, Erin. My name is Catherine Erickson, and I lead technology partnership here at DataStacks. And I'm really excited to show this new integration with DCOS 1.9.
In today's webinar, we'll start with an overview of DCOS, which is a production-proven platform for building and running modern enterprise applications. Next, Catherine will provide an overview of DataStacks, which is a scalable distributed database based on Apache Cassandra. We'll also cover the benefits and use cases for running DataStacks on Mesosphere DCOS, and we'll finish with a demo. Several years ago, Marc Andreessen basically argued that all companies really need to become software companies to stay competitive. So it's really disrupt or become disrupted. And if you look at today's, you know, most successful companies in any industry, you know, whether that's the booksellers or video services or music companies, they've all had to become software companies to be successful. If you look at the world today, everyone is increasingly connected, whether that's businesses, users, and the apps that actually power that engagement. And nearly everyone carries, you know, multiple connected devices. So there's something like 13 on average connected devices per household in North America. And a lot of data is actually being generated by our activities and by IoT devices. And this explosive growth in users and the amount of data has real strong implications for the software that businesses need to build and operate. So how do businesses need to change the way that they're building and operating their applications? The first thing is that nearly all the companies that Mesosphere works with are really looking to build more applications more quickly and to better engage their customers. Second, companies must innovate much faster than ever before. If you look at the application lifecycle, it's no longer acceptable to roll out a new service or updates to that service every 6 to 12 months. Finally, companies really want to leverage the data that they're collecting on user engagement and operational metrics and also do it in a cost-effective manner. So IT must be able to be scalable to meet the requirements of these customers and the huge amount of data that they create and consume, but at the same time, it must be cost-effective and secure. Building and delivering these modern data-driven services means modern apps. And modern enterprise apps really require a new set of capabilities. The first is cloud-native technologies. So many companies turn to the cloud to access these, and many also try to develop these capabilities in-house using open source technology. The second is distributed computing expertise. So architecting, deploying, and operating distributed systems is actually much more complex compared to the requirements for monolithic applications. And finally, companies need to be able to roll out new services much more quickly to serve their customers. And so all of this can be very challenging for most enterprises, and a lot of value gets left on the table. A recent study by McKinsey actually found that of all the data that's captured from the 30,000 sensors on a modern oil rig, less than 1% of that ever actually gets used in decision-making or improving operations. And so companies are basically sitting on all of this data that they can't get value from because they don't have the required technologies, skills, and operational practices. So what do companies do if they can't develop these capabilities in-house? The transition to cloud has really helped companies quickly get access to what we call the platform services or building blocks to build these modern enterprise applications. So things like container orchestration, CI/CD platforms, and a broad range of data services are some examples of these platform building blocks. On the cloud, companies can use and pay only for the services that they need, and they don't really need to worry about how these platform services are run, which means they don't need to become experts at these services. And cloud certainly provides elasticity and scale of those services. However, there's some real challenges in building and running everything in the cloud, in that companies can find themselves tied to one service provider. One recent example from the news is Snap, which is the company behind Snapchat. They recently issued their S-1 ahead of their IPO, where they share some of their key business risks. In it, it basically says of the $500 million annual loss, $400 million is actually part of their commitment to Google Cloud. And so using cloud services is not inherently bad, but in Snap's case, they have built their applications against platform services that are unique to the Google Cloud. And so this means that if Google ever changed prices or decided to retire certain platform services, Snap would be a serious risk because they have no alternatives. And that's really the power of Mesosphere DCOS. So Mesosphere allows companies to use cloud-native applications, but it also provides them the freedom to run on any infrastructure, whether that's on-premise data center or on any cloud. So Mesosphere DCOS is the only production-proven platform that powers both of the modern app components, containers and data services, so businesses can accelerate time to market with confidence and save. DCOS essentially turns the data center into one giant computer. And so with DCOS, all components of modern apps can be pooled, whether that's containerized microservices, big data services for analytics, and data persistence. And so this approach effectively abstracts modern apps with the underlying infrastructure. So what does that actually look like? This is the UI of DCOS. The CLI and the UI allow you to look at your entire data center as if it were a giant computer. You do have the ability to look at individual nodes and see what is running on them if necessary. This is a view of the DCOS universe. The universe is a package repository for both open source and partner-supported packages that can be installed on DCOS with just a few clicks. The reason why we call ourselves a data center operating system is that we actually want our partners to be successful building applications that can be run on DCOS. So an operating system is really only as powerful as the applications that run on it. Today we have over 100 services that are available on our universe, including DataStax Enterprise. I'll wrap up with some examples of how some of our customers are using DCOS. Esri is a geospatial analytics company, and they essentially take streaming information from sensors and provide real-time mapping services to their customers. Esri needs to be able to scale to cover events as big as the Boston Marathon. So Esri utilizes Apache Kafka, Apache Spark, and Spark Streaming, Elasticsearch, and Okka to bring their service to market. And DCOS really allows them to improve the time they take to process the real-time information that's coming in terms of a three orders of magnitude improvement. And Verizon is another great example. Verizon has to run apps and services that touch millions of subscribers. And Verizon chose DCOS because it really allows them to more easily adopt the necessary components for microservices and data processing and analytics services such as Apache Spark. And so Verizon uses Mesosphere DCOS across thousands of nodes and across multiple data centers and is continuing to expand their deployment. Hopefully now you have a better understanding of the power of Mesosphere DCOS. Next, I'll hand it over to Catherine to cover DataStax Enterprise.
Thanks, Erin. At the core of DataStax Enterprise, we use Cassandra as our data store. Cassandra is different because it scales and it won't fail. Cassandra is a masterless, self-healing mesh with no single point of failure and true linear scalability. When we say linear scalability, we really mean that if you have a 4-node cluster getting 100,000 transactions per second, an 8-node cluster will double that. Apple is on record having over 100,000 Cassandra nodes deployed within the iCloud group alone with tens of petabytes under management. They've got many clusters in excess of 1,000 nodes, each performing in excess of 1 million operations per second. No other database technology can deliver this type of scale. Additionally, our concept of a cluster includes multiple data centers. All replication is done in real time, with replication latencies between data centers of less than a second. This means that our data centers are active-active. The application can write to any data center and is replicated everywhere in real time. This allows you to move your data to where your customer is, resulting in a better customer experience. But it also means that you can ingest data from endpoints around the world. And while you can do this between geographic locations, you can also replicate between geographies and clouds. What DataStax does is take on all of those design principles of Cassandra and extends them into an enterprise platform. Most people on the webinar are probably familiar with DataStax. The version of Cassandra we bundle is enterprise ready and battle tested, but we also offer other enterprise features customers need, like advanced security, management services, end memory tables, and more advanced replication options. And then on this foundation, we add search, analytics, and graph. As part of the management options, DataStax offers a lifecycle manager as part of OpsCenter, which many customers use to deploy and manage their own clusters. They use Lifecycle Manager to create clusters with just a few clicks, to manage configuration for them, and to manage the security options for interacting and deploying those clusters. But before our partnership with Mesosphere, you still had to bring your own servers, set up and configure those servers, point OpsCenter to them, and install all necessary prereqs for DataStax to run. But what we're all here today to talk about is why DataStax is better in partnership with Mesosphere. For starters, the infrastructure side of things is automated. You skip the infrastructure planning stage and jump right to the deployment. But this isn't just important for making it easier to install DataStax Enterprise. Our customers are telling us that they want to deploy all apps in a singular enterprise fashion. That's the real value here. Customers still need to test and make their deployment options, but once your configuration is locked in, you can deploy DataStax and your other apps over and over in clusters large and small. That's exactly the use case with the first customer we deliver this integration to. Their setup was very similar to the SmackStack architecture that many are familiar with and that you see on this slide. Events come in and are queued in Kafka, streamed with Spark, persisted in DataStax Enterprise, and consumed by equally scalable and resilient modern applications. By putting in the extra effort upfront to really think through their use case and formalize their workflow, they have an end-to-end process that can be deployed all at once without error or deployed in multiple instances around the world. While this partnership was coming together last fall, we did have a basic offering, but the story is much better now with the newest version of DCOS. We've developed the new integration against the Mesosphere Partner SDK, which enables monitoring, debugging, metrics, logging, and troubleshooting capabilities through the DCOS interface.
Thank you, Catherine, for providing a great overview of why you'd want to run DataStax Enterprise on DCOS. So why would you want to run any data services on DCOS a little bit more generally? So this could include things like Apache Kafka, which is a message queue, or Apache Spark as an analytics engine. The first is on-demand provisioning. So with DCOS, you can install these services with just a few clicks from a catalog of over 100 different services. This allows you to save time on deploying new data services, also allows you to avoid having to find specialized talent, and finally, it allows developers to really experiment with new data services. Second is simplified operations. And so with DCOS, you can do things like runtime software upgrades, runtime application settings update. So these will basically allow you to do updates to your to services like Kafka and services like DataStax Enterprise with no downtime and no maintenance windows. We also provide monitoring and metrics that are sent out from the services, and finally manage persistent storage volumes. So this really reduces maintenance windows as well as unplanned downtime and allows you to save on operator time. Third is elastic data infrastructure. And so by pooling multiple data services as well as containerized apps on the same infrastructure, you're able to dramatically increase utilization. We also make it very easy to resize as well as add more instances. And next, I'll hand it back over to DataStax to do a demo on how DataStax Enterprise runs on DCOS.
Hi, I'm going to show you a quick demo of our latest integration with Enterprise DCOS. In this dashboard, you will find the SE package here. We're going to choose Advanced Installation. Here you can define your service name. Then you can define your cluster properties. By default, we enable DSE Search, DSE Analytics, and DSE Graph. If you do not want any of these options, you can uncheck them or enable them here. Next, we go into the DSE Node tab. Here you can define number of nodes and the CPU count for each node and your design memory and other configurable parameters. In this package, you also have the option to spin up an ops center. And you can also set up authentication with ops center. There are two options. One is called internal authentication. The second option is to enable LDAP. In this package, we also offer you to spin up a DataStax Studio. It is our developer tools to create graphs and traverse your graph database. If you do not need DataStax Studio in your installation, you can uncheck it. Next tab is Cassandra. This represents the Cassandra.yaml configuration file. Here you can define number of tokens and also a lot of other configurable fields. And lastly, the DSE tab represents the DSE.yaml configuration file. Here you can define many different DSE options for search, for analytics, for graph, and also LDAP configuration, and so on and so forth. So this is one way to create a DSE instance, right? A DSE instance can consist of DSE nodes, op center, right? Studio, and you can also configure your Cassandra YAML and DSE YAML in this user-friendly user interface. So let me also show you another way to deploy. So here I have two files, two configuration files. If you want to deploy using the CLI, then you probably have to create a file, right? Config file like this. And this we call the config.json file. You can define number of nodes here, right? And the memory size and the heap size. And the agent, DataStax agent, CPU accounts. And also other port settings. And if you want to enable off-center LDAP, you know, configuration, you can also, you know, set up here. Basically, what you can do in the GUI is exactly what you can do in this config file. And this option gives you a more consistent and repeatable deployment. And with this config file, you can version control it so that you can, you know, create your DSE instance in a more consistent way. So after you're set with settings all these values, you can have a final reviewed before you click the install button. So I'm not going to create a new DSE instance. So what I'm going to do to show you what I've done earlier, click on the service tab. You will see a DSE service running. If you are successfully deploy a DSE package, you should see a bunch of tasks created in the your DSE service. These represent node number 1, 2, and 3. Altogether, there are 3 nodes in this DSE package. And we also enable the auth centers. In this particular instance, I did not enable Studio. That's why you don't see a Studio task here. And next up, I want to show you the auth centers interface. In this DSE package, we have these endpoints features. You can run DCOS, DSE endpoints. This will return a bunch of endpoints. You can access the web UI. Say we want to access the auth center. So what I would do is type DCOS DSE endpoints auth centers. So once we have this information, I'm going to open it in the browser. Here you go. We see the 3 node clusters, and we enable analytics, graph, and search. And there are 3 nodes here. You can manage your cluster from the op centers. So everything looks good. Next, I'm going to show you how we can access one of the DSE nodes through CQLSH. After we go into one of the Meso agents, I can run this command. So I can get into one of the DSE nodes. Then I describe key spaces. So let me do a quick summary of what we have shown you today. Number 1 is you can easily search up on the DSE package in DCOS universe. 2, you have 2 options to install a DSE package. One is through the GUI. The other way is through the config.json file. Each has its own benefits. Then we used the DCOS DSE endpoints command line to search up on all the possible web UIs. And after that, we can find out the auth center's web UI. Then we open an auth center dashboard. Then you can start managing your DSE clusters using auth centers. And finally, I show you a way to.
Thank you for that great demo. So before we close out, we want to provide you with a few resources so you can get started today. The first is the joint solution brief that covers at a high level what Mesosphere is, what DataStax is, and some of the benefits and use cases for running the technologies together. The second is you can go ahead and visit dcos.io and download the open source version of DCOS. And if you look in the universe, you can deploy DataStax in minutes. And next, we'll open it up to questions. Feel free to use the box on the right-hand side of your display to type any questions, and we'll happily respond to them. For any of those that we don't have time to answer in this time period, we'll get back to you after the webinar. Great, so one of the first questions that we got is which DataStax products are available on DCOS?
Sure, this is Catherine Erickson with DataStax. Right now you have DataStax Enterprise 5, And it supports all the major features of GSE5, so search, analytics, graph, you know, advanced security, battle-tested Cassandra. Everything is there. I think I see another question that came in on the line is, can we get a copy of the slides?
So we'll be providing a recording of the webinar, and then you can access the slides as well.
Great.
And one other question that we got is, can you run data stacks on open source DCOS rather than just enterprise DCOS? It is possible to try out data stacks using open source DCOS, but it's not supported. So if you want to do this in a real way, we recommend that you contact Mesosphere and data stacks for enterprise licenses and support.
Right. It's also not something data stacks is going to support for data stacks customers running on an open DCOS. This is a new integration. We're adding features for customers all the time, and we work really closely with the Mesosphere engineers to do that. So it really is in partnership at this point. There's a question online that I can take. What is your recommended disk volume size for each of the data nodes? What AWS EC2 type or disk do you recommend for use of GSE Cassandra for performance? The best performance you're going to get with DataStax and Amazon is on the I2 instances. I believe those may have just been replaced with a new naming. But in terms of disk, it's definitely going to be match the disk to your use case. If it's a high-performance disk use case, you're going to want local SSD. That's always our recommendation. But we have a lot of customers seeing great performance with EVS storage. It's something that we can help you out with. It's something that you should test. But all of those options are available within DCOS. Is the multi-data center, this is a new question, this is still Catherine at DataStax, is the multi-data center deployment handled by DCOS under the hood? It's made possible by DCOS exposing portions of DataStax Enterprise that handle geographic replication. So I believe that question was around the multi-DC features of DataStax Enterprise, the ability to replicate data geographically around the world and take in data from endpoints anywhere. That's a feature of DataStax exposed through DCOS. One question, does the integration support DSE features like DSE authentication? Yes, it does. Gilbert, do you want to elaborate on that one at all?
Absolutely. This is Gilbert from DataStax, and in regards to the DataStax authentication, so basically you can connect to an existing AD or LDAP servers to your DSE node, as well as the op center. And we also allow you to enable internal authentication on the Cassandra database and also op center.
Great. So I think that looks like the remainder of the questions. Of course, if you think of questions later, feel free to either email Mesosphere or DataStax, and we'll be happy to answer your questions. Thank you. Special thanks to Kat and Gilbert from DataStax for joining us today, and we hope you enjoy this webinar. Thank you.